Tell me a fact and I'll learn. Tell me a truth and I'll believe. But tell me a story and it will live in my heart forever. The Names Not Numbers Oral History Film Documentary Project is remembering the stories of the Holocaust and is telling the story of the Holocaust for the world to hear, for the world to learn, and to inspire future generations to combat anti-Semitism and all forms of hatred and intolerance. This unique project is in its 16th year. Over 2,500 survivors and 6,000 students have participated in it worldwide. The students were instructed by teachers and professionals. They learned interviewing techniques from journalists. They learned filming techniques and editing skills from documentary filmmakers. The students interviewed, filmed, and edited the two-hour interviews with each survivor to make 20-minute oral histories that are compiled in the Names Not Numbers documentary at the school. You're about to view the documentary Names Not Numbers, A Movie in the Making. This film chronicles the students as they are being trained by the professionals and includes their reflections. In it is embedded approximately 10 minutes from each interview. This is the students' work, their filmed and edited interviews. Through this project, our students are preserving history, and they are the witnesses to the witnesses.
He described us as all having kinky brown hair, all having a reddish complexion, and all having huge, crooked noses. The Jews were a race.
You couldn't go to restaurants. They said no Jews allowed. I mean, you know, it was full force.
They were marching and then saying, Krummer Jud Roosevelt wird vernichtet aus der Welt. I remember the songs. Lame Jew Roosevelt will be destroyed in this world.
The German hit mama with a stick, hit over the head.
The police were taking kids and banded them together with ropes and they threw them to the Danube.
We saw our father, and when he saw us without hair, he was crying.
Our name was not a name. My number was 57,490. 6 million are not here. I'm here.
We are making sure that the lives that were taken during the Holocaust don't just remain a number, and it was just, yeah, 6 million, but rather each person has a name to it. And we accomplish that by turning to survivors. We have the privilege to speak with them. We have the privilege to learn from them. We have a privilege to tell their stories.
This program, Names Not Numbers, is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity that each and every one of us is lucky and privileged to have.
Mrs. Tova Fisher Rosenberg speak to us about the whole project and what it has accomplished.
Today, 75 years after the end of the Holocaust, 31% of all Americans believe that 2 million or fewer Jews were killed in the Holocaust. Among young Americans, 66% of them could not identify Auschwitz as a concentration or death camp.
For me, that was a really shocking and surprising thing to hear, that, you know, so many people could deny such a major event in our history.
This is the last generation that has the privilege to hear the survivors' testimonies firsthand. Our names, not numbers students are learning history, recording history, and preserving history through their work.
Today we had a speaker, Rabbi Levin. He gave a very impactful speech.
Forgetting was never an option. Remembering is a noble and necessary act. No commandment figures so frequently, so insistently in the Bible. It is incumbent upon us to remember the good we received and the evil we have suffered.
He emphasized the importance of commemorating this because it is a watershed moment in Jewish history. It is an incredibly significant moment for us to retell these stories. It's incredibly impactful.
We don't have so many more years with these survivors, and just being able to get their stories out and personally being able to be the ones to hear it from them face to face, not just by watching on a video, means a lot to me, and it will mean a lot to future generations who are going to be able to actually hear it and watch it so they never forget.
My family has a long time ago went through the Holocaust, but I was not old enough to meet them before they passed away. So I'm really looking forward to meeting somebody who actually experienced what they also experienced so I can understand what they went through.
Nazis, they tried to push us down, Jews down, and they put numbers on their arms to try to like make them seem like they're just numbers, but no, they're real people. And we're trying to tell their stories.
We had a journalist speak to us from ABC News.
He taught us a lot of good skills of how to do an interview.
The most important skill is going to be listening. Listening for every word that they say to make sure you don't miss something vital.
Gave us an incredible insight into the behind the scenes and some of the process that we will be doing.
An open-ended question is a question where they have space to answer. And a closed question is where you've given them no room to answer.
Teaching us how to engage with a participant and what type of questions to ask. And it was really nice to learn basically how to do an interview.
Barak came to teach us about how filming works for interviewing purposes.
The rule of thirds says that things are gonna look better. In the most simple way to put it is like they're gonna look better if they're off center.
We learned that we shouldn't have the main point of focus be in the center of the screen because that's not as entertaining as in those four points.
Using the camera was a new experience for me, but I think I got the hang of using it.
Using the cameras, it was an experience I'd never done before, but I think that with the help of Barak really helped me capture the moment.
Learning how to use the cameras and audio equipment was really interesting. Just having not been around that kind of technology, it's really cool to be able to control the behind the scenes of such a special project.
Today we went to the Illinois Holocaust Museum, and we went with a docent who showed us all different aspects of World War II and the Holocaust itself, all the way from the beginning when Hitler was rose to power, through what happened in Germany, Poland, even Shanghai and Russia, all the way to the end, and even to anti-Semitism today.
They killed 1.5 million Jewish children. See, we had no use for them.
All they needed is the people in the concentration camps. They were cheap labor, and they needed the Jews to help them with making bullets and things that would help them conquer the rest of the world.
The hologram of Sam Harris was a Holocaust survivor who was recently filmed, and we were able to sort of ask him questions, and he told us his experience throughout the Holocaust.
To prepare for interviewing Mr. Hale Katz, we made a bio and looked up all his whole story and created questions based on his story.
Today we're going to be interviewing a Holocaust survivor named Eva Ritt.
We're about to interview Ark Khanuk,
Ralph Rehbock,
John Traurig,
Harold Katz,
Elizabeth Malina.
We're in Detroit. Today we're going to interview Mr. Weiss. In
I'm feeling a little anxious, but I'm also excited to hear what he has to say.
Feeling a little nervous, I haven't done this before.
But I think this is going to be a great experience to hear his story and to get to know him.
I'm feeling amazing. I'm really excited to hear her story.
A little anxious, a little nervous.
I'm feeling a little nervous, to be honest, because it's a big deal. This is a lot of pressure.
I feel really privileged to have this unique experience to meet one-on-one with a Holocaust survivor and be able to know more about that individual's lifetime and what they went through.
My name is Ralph Max Rehbock, Meir Ben Naftali. I was born on July 11th, 1934, in Gotha, Germany.
My name is Eva London Ritt. My Hebrew name is Chava. I was born on January 23rd, 1933, in Hamburg, Germany, outside of the city in a place called Klein Flottbek.
My Hebrew name is Meir Leib Weiss. I was born November 9, 1924, in a little village. It was Czechoslovakia.
My name is Elizabeth Malina. I am born 9/16/23 in Czechoslovakia in Turja, Paseka.
My name is Harold Katz, Zvi. I was born May 15, 1928 in Tarn, Czechoslovakia.
My name is John Schlomer Traurig, a Kohen. So that what introduces reasonably well. I was born in January 1935 in Czechoslovakia.
My name is Arkady Khanuk. Short name is Ark. Hebrew name is Avrum. I born in Ukraine. It's a small city, Brailov, 7 July 1935.
My father was Hans Rehbock, and my mother, Ruth Nussbaum Rehbock. I am an only child. In Germany, my mother was a dental hygienist, one of the first in the world. My father, after high school, became a part of his father's company, which is called Rippelwerk, which was a manufacturer of metal housewares, and he was the export manager for that company. In my mother's family, she had six brothers and sisters, and the father was a cattle dealer. There have been nine generations of family members, and all lived in Germany.
My father's name was Max London, and my mother's name was Charlotte Bianca Wolf London. I have an older sister, Ruth, my brother Edgar, and I was the baby of the family. My father's family lived in Hamburg for hundreds of years. My father was in partnership with an old friend of his, and they were like middlemen to coffee and things like that, from factory to retail. In Germany, my mother did not have to do housework, and she was dressed in the most beautiful clothes, and they had a good life. First day of school, which was traditional to have this cone-shaped large thing, and it was filled with goodies. I was taken to a professional photographer to take the picture, that's what. And I have a little purse, and I have my school bag attached to my bag. I never knew any of my grandparents, because they were all gone before I was born, but I had great aunts and uncles. Before the war, my family had an idyllic life.
My father's name was Avrum Yitzhak Weiss, and many of my grandchildren and great-grandchildren all called Avrum Yitzhak. My mother's name was Henche. My father was a tailor. We lived like in a little neighborhood. We spoke only Yiddish. To Heder we went in the morning at 6 o'clock, and we were there till 8 o'clock. Because 8 o'clock, we have to attend the Hungarian school.
My village was Turja, Paseka. They were talking Ukrainian. We were talking with my parents Yiddish and Hungarian. I had very nice parents, 5 children, 4 daughters and a son. My father was Yossel, Joseph, and my mama was Miriam. My brother was Pinchas. My sister, the older, was Miriam. The other sister was Chaya, Helen. One more sister was Louise Rechel, Yiddish Rechel. We had even a Heider. My father said we should know Yiddish, so he hired a teacher, and he taught us Davin and everything. There were 30 Jewish families in our little village. And we went to shul. Even we were small girls, but we went to shul. Our neighbors were non-Jews, but they were nice to us. My father had a little store. We had like a farm too. My mom likes to have chicken and turkey and goose. So we had this too in our house, and we had 2 cows. My mom was cooking and baking for 7 people. There wasn't a bakery, there wasn't a kosher meat shop, nothing. It was a hard life, but we did what we could.
It was a small town. There was 100 Jewish people living in it. We had a synagogue, and we had a Hebrew school. My mother was a housewife, and my father was transferring material from store for stores to our hometown and from another big city, Hust. We were 9 kids, 4 girls and 5 boys. I'm the 5th child, Hensa, Hannah, Moshe, Isaac, Hersh, Bertzi, Bumi, Rivka, Rezi. We were very close together, and we all loved each other. I went to Hebrew school in the morning, and I went in the afternoon to Heider.
My parents' names was Gisela and Isidore Traurig. My father opened the store. It was the most go-ahead menswear store in the area. My mother stayed home, and she was helping to take us to Heider and to school. That's what she did. And she did a good job of it. I had a younger brother, and we were the only 2. When I was 3 years old, they put me into a Heider class, and we were learning Chumash.
My parents' name is Mama is Frida Khanuk and Erschel Khanuk, the father. My father was a butcher, and my mother was a homemade. They're a very lovely couple. They always cared about the kids. Zhenya, my sister, older sister. It's a small town. It's most Jewish people live in there. My granddad, he have own horses, and like a taxi, he used to have. He used to live to 103 years. We have a small synagogue, and my father always and grandfather, they used to go.
My father made the Seder, and there was an Afikomen. He showed us everything, what's going on. We should know we are Jewish. My mom used to make Friday 5 like this breads. She was baking bread. She was baking a little sweets. But we had always something. Makosh, kokosh. For Shabbos, we have eggs, I am with Sweep. We have a little cholent, a little meat, a little potato kugel. My mom make the chabas good.
If we had fried fish and challah, it was a wonderful Shabbos. The Pesach Seder was so much money that we have to count. I remember we had 8 matzah per day. I asked my Zaidi the 4 kvashas, and when he said, L'shuna habubi Yerushalayim, he cried with my tatan. I don't know, I didn't know at that time what he cried for.
We lived across the street from the synagogue, and we went to the synagogue Friday night and came back singing Shalom Aleichem and things like that, the same as everywhere else, just like normal Jews, regular, did. For Shabbat, we had to take a cholent to the baker to put into the oven. And as we were kids, there's always they were talking about, is there a chazar feast in the cholent? In other words, he was trying to making it interesting to talk. And you know, you say, we don't have a chazar feast in cholent. So that was the sort of a joke with the Mr. Wiesner, who was the baker. I remember the seders that we did have, and we were reading the Manishtana, and everybody was involved. And my father was, he had a nice singing voice, so it was just a pleasure to listen to him.
My mother cooked, then baked. We had cholent, we had challah, and we had fish. I was my mother's helper. We went to the synagogue whenever there was Sabbat. It was a nice synagogue. My father had a place where he was always sitting. We sat next to him. We all loved each other. We listened to each other and we lived a normal life.
My mother lit the candles Friday night and we celebrated Hanukkah and we used to play a game, Poch. That game is so old, it comes from the Middle Ages practically. And there was a traditional game on Hanukkah to play that game.
In Gotha, the Jewish life revolved around the synagogue. We were liberal Jews. Liberal Judaism began in Germany, and that's what ultimately became conservative Judaism and Reform Judaism in America. They did not keep kosher because they were not Orthodox. They lived a Jewish life with regard to holidays. It was a very normal middle-class life that we led with many cousins and aunts and uncles that celebrated holidays together and always spending time on the grandparents' farm. There was all happiness and a very, very nice life. Non-Jewish neighbors was wonderful until Hitler came to power, and then the non-Jewish neighbors withdrew from friendship. He described us to the public as all having kinky brown hair, all having a reddish complexion, and all having huge crooked noses. A sign went up in my grandfather's cattle dealer saying, don't buy from these Jews. And my mother was fired from her job in 1935 because she worked for a non-Jewish dentist, and no Jew could work for a non-Jew after the Nuremberg Laws were created in 1935. The Nuremberg Laws were so specific and so detailed that every aspect of Jewish life was certainly affected.
You couldn't go to restaurants. They said no Jews allowed. I mean, you know, it was full force. We had a German shepherd dog called Lux, and apparently he'd been a Nazi in the pants. So he was a good Jewish dog. My family, they had a lovely house where in Kleinflottbek, where I was born, and they moved from that to go into the city. They moved because of anti-Semitism. The super or whatever it is in the apartment building, he had his little girl with him. And he told her to turn around and not look at the Jews. There was a conference. They were asked to take Jews in, and nobody wanted to take in Jews. So Hitler said, okay, I can go ahead. And that's when everything started. You couldn't just leave. You had to have somebody in the United States vouch for you financially. And my mother had a cousin in Baltimore, Maryland, who had run away from home. And her mother, my grandmother, took her in and treated her kindly. And she always remembered that. And when it came time, that's who they contacted. And I have a copy of the paper where they have filled out the form and what their salary, you know, what income they had. And they saved our life.
My parents made contact with a cousin living in Chicago in 1938. And my mother got on a boat and he got permission to go to Chicago by way of New York just by herself, to contact the family in Chicago in person, asking them to do the appropriate paperwork so that maybe our paperwork would be accepted and we would get visas to go into America. We had to give up all of our money, all of our insurance policies, everything that had value were turned over to the government. And in place of all of those monies that were turned over to the government, we were allowed to take everything, all of our furniture, all of our dishes, all of our silverware, all of my toys, all of our books, everything that we owned that we wanted to have in America. It was a 6-hour train ride from Gotha to Berlin. We were invited to the embassy to be there of all the dates that they had picked. We were supposed to be there in the morning of November 10th, 1938. My mother, my father, and I got to Berlin on the 8th because we didn't want to be late for our appointment on the 10th. The night of the 9th of November, the three of us, father, mother, child, were in our hotel room across the street from a synagogue. And that synagogue that evening was burning.
My mother had to run to the school to get my brother from the Talmud Torah. The synagogue next to it was burning.
1,400 synagogues were destroyed that night. We didn't know anything until going down the stairs of the hotel the next morning in order to have our interview in the embassy. A sign was up saying no Jews allowed.
Children could no longer go to school with non-Jews. In my school, there were non-Jews. And we all had to go to the Jüdische Tochterschule, which was the girls' Jewish school. We had to move out of our apartment as Jews and had to move to another building that was just for Jews. My father had a very good friend who was his partner in business who was not Jewish. They were very close. But sadly, before we left, he joined the Nazi party and would have nothing to do with my parents, though his wife went to visit them secretly.
30,000 Jewish men between the ages of 16 and 60 were arrested just because they were Jewish. One of those men was my Uncle Salo, who had been a wounded war veteran of World War I. He was one of the 91 people that were killed the night of Kristallnacht. The same order for the 30,000 men applied to my father. There was a young Jewish girl in our home that night as a house sitter. And the Gestapo came for my father and said, "Where is Herr Rehbock?" Her answer was, and thank goodness it was, I don't know. The moment that they left in disgust, made a call to the hotel room, and in German said, the English lesson is canceled. All phones were tapped, and my father and the young lady had made a pact and a code, so to speak, that if anything happened, not knowing in advance what might happen, make a phone call to us, collect in our hotel room, and use those words, and I will know that I should never come home again.
In 1939, they were marching, where they said, Krumer, you, Roosevelt, wird vernichtet aus der Welt. It means lame Jew, Roosevelt, will be destroyed from this world. And I remembered it because they liked singing it. My parents were wearing stars, and I was eventually wearing a star. My father knew they were murdering people, but he didn't know any details, and nobody knew any details. And the Nazis worked very hard to cover up what they were doing. We escaped. So my father, he sent us to Hungary. My dad got us buggy and a horse. It brought and put a can of milk on top of it. My father said, you will go and drive this horse. You know how to drive. And you will drive the buggy and drive it to Hungary and go to this baker, my mother's friend's bakery, and you will deliver the milk there. And you tell them the details that you're going to stay in Hungary.
The real Nazis actually were the Hungarians. Oh, they came in 1941, right before I was supposed to be bar mitzvah. They came, just put your blanket and go to the synagogue. We were in the synagogue at night, and the trucks came in the morning, and they took us to Hust. And there they put us on train wagons, and they took us to Poland. And in Poland, they let us off, and they say, you could go this way, you cannot go this way. And we were wandering, the whole family, from one town to another town. My father had a sister, she got married to Poland. And we stayed by her until the Nazis came, and later on they shot every Jew in the house. But my father knew about the border. We were close living near the border, and there was a family who they didn't take them away. They had trucks, and they came with a big truck. They loaded up the lumber, and they made some room for underneath the lumber to sit. And they took us to Hust, and in Hust, we stopped with the truck, and we got off the truck. We went into a house, a Jewish house over there, and the drivers wanted to rest up. It was in the morning, and some of the police came around to the truck, and they did not look underneath that lumber to see us. They didn't come into the house, and the driver was outside, and they were questioning him and also hitting him, like his blood was coming through his face. But he didn't tell that he got us, you know, and saved our lives.
They took out the license from my father, no more Jewish stores. They came in, they took us all. They said, we cannot take nothing from house. Our chicken and turkey and all, they were coming after us, like they feel we never gonna come back. They took us to a ghetto. We were in ghetto for a while with my parents and the sisters, but my brother was a soldier in this time, so he wasn't with us. But they gave us a day, a little soup, a little, it was hard.
A law came out that everybody should go to the schoolyard. And we slept there overnight. In the morning, they brought in horse and wagons, and they took us to Berexas. It's a bigger city. And there, they put us into a brick factory. That brick factory had about 40, 50 long barracks. But those barracks did not have doors or windows. Usually, the kitchen was big enough to feed the people who were there, 60, 70 people. Now, we are 18,000 people in the same kitchen. They brought in from the whole county, the Jews, into barracks, into that brick factory. Ladies took off their wedding rings, and those who had diamond rings, and gave it away for some bread and milk, what the farmers brought in, for milk for the children, bread for the children. And one morning, a German soldier went through the barrack, and they said all valuables. They put a bucket to the door, put them in there, and the rabbi had a pocket watch, and he showed it to the soldier. If he can keep that, the value is nothing, but he needs it. He needs it for religious reason. He took him out to the yard, and he took all of us out to the yard. Now, the German had a whip, my Amina, my belief in God, that he won't be able to hit that rabbi. And he hit him. And this was my first disappointment. We stayed there 6 weeks. From Pesach 6 weeks, we are at Anschwitz.
A woman and a man, sister and brother, they got this, they got separated somehow from their parents. Their parents also was deported to that city from Budapest, from Hungary. And they asked us if we could spend a little time and if we could help them. So my father accepted them, and he decided to go back to Poland and bring my mother and my rest of the family over the same way we came. And they came to Pust with us, and she was married. She had a husband that they took him to the army, you know. She called him, and he came and took her back to Budapest, sister and brother, and they took me along with. I stayed in Budapest until the Nazis, German Nazis, occupied Budapest. They made the Jews to wear a yellow band on the arm,
They were very bad. The Nazis, or the Hungarian Nazis, they gave guns to the young group, and they were marching with Jewish people to the ghetto. I ran away from the Jewish section where I lived. I rented a room in a house. I stayed over there for weeks in that house, and I bought peas and I ate only peas. I got in touch with some people, which was a Zionist organization, and they gave me false papers. There was a group of younger people. They helped people to go to move to Israel.
When the war started, my father, they took him to the army. When the German come to the house, which a policeman, Ukrainian policeman, and the policeman asked my mother for money, for gold, and they took us out outside. The German hit the mama with nagaika, with a stick, hit over the head. I was scared, and my sister hold me and try, you know, calm down, no. I was crying. And took me, my mama and my sister to this big street, like a lot, a big one. Everybody's Jewish was staying there. They start asking who's have a profession, a shoemaker, or what different type profession. And the mother, she, some, I don't know, maybe God to help you or whatever, she grabbed me by the hand and moved to this place where the professional, from the place over here to here. I don't know, I think God took her. That's really she, yeah. She just, I don't know. She just took me and moved to this side and saved us. Everybody, they went and was shot. And we, people with the profession, they moved to different, like a different houses, I think 4 or 5 houses. Mama met the woman and she say, she hear Zmerinka, it's a city, and she say it's a ghetto there. What Romanian control the ghetto. She say the mother, she can take us to Zmerinka, this is 8 kilometers. And it was very, very cold. The winter is so bad, was like 30 below zero. And at night, she was agreed to take us. And at night she took, and I was, couldn't walk, it's cold, and I don't have, we don't have the proper dress, you know, we just, and I no had nothing out of my feet. The rivers was frozen with bodies. And we walked through the bodies to pass, because you don't have like a bridge, nothing, just dead people. When I was walking a little bit after this, I became tired. And she did, and like care of, like in a bag, she took me this, and she took us, somehow we make it to the ghetto.
In order to cross the English Channel, you had to take what was called a boat train at the time. They put trains on barges, which went across the English Channel to get us then to England, so that we could get to Southampton, where our ship, the SS Manhattan, was going to be leaving from. My parents on the ship made it clear to both me and to each other that once they got to America, they would not be speaking German anymore.
I was 7 years old when I left Hamburg. And my mother had a cousin in Baltimore, Maryland. My relatives contacted my mother's relatives by mail, and they saved our life. We were the last ones to leave. We left around May 15th, and just a few days a bit later, they started roundup of Jews. When we left by train to go to Genoa to catch our ship, first of all, when we got on the border, the German guards said, "Your papers aren't in order to my father, you have to get off the train." Well, if we would have gotten off the train, I wouldn't be sitting here. There were three ships in Genoa. One had left before we got there. We had reservations on all three. The second one we got on, and the third one never left.
After the ghetto, straight to Auschwitz. They put us into freight trains.
Open wagons, 250, 300, but all kind. Small children, old babies. They said, "We are going to work." So we were thinking, how come little children in like this to work? But we didn't know where we are going.
The train ride during the day, it was hot. During the night, it was cold.
They give us a little bread and a little margarine. So with this, we were the whole night and the whole day.
There was no bathroom in there or anything. In one compartment, 80 people. Usually put there 60. Now that was torture.
Children were crying. People were crying. Odd people, they were dying, falling down. And it was terrible to see this. It was dark, 1 o'clock.
After we got to Auschwitz, there were selections.
This was Mengele, and he said, left, right, left, right.
They just looked at you, and they made up their mind who should live, who should die. My father told me, you have to survive to take care of your mother. And my mother went right away to the gas chamber.
The youngest, a little like us, on the right side, and the other one on the left side. When we were walking to the spa, we saw on the streets talas and all kind of Jewish stuff. We smell something, and not far from us was the gas camera. So it was a bad feeling for us. Where we are going, what's gonna be? No, they took us to a spa and they cut our hair and everything. They give us lousy clothes. They give me a dress full of lies. We saw our father, and when he saw us without hair, he was very crying. They took us in a block, 250 girls to sleep, block C-29. We were four sisters and one mother. 11-8-32-8.
A lady was feeding her pig, and they gave the pig cooked potato pills. And when we went through it, everybody took a grab of those potato pills, and she complained to the guard that we ate up the pig's food. I just stayed in Auschwitz 2 weeks, and it looked to me like 2 years.
In the city, I was caught. I wanted to help a family to get false papers for them also. I was sent to the concentration camp in Kisztorcsa. They brought me there with the chains on my feet. I was working for a barber. The barber was also a prisoner, but he was a barber. And he was taking care of the people in the camp, giving them shaves and haircuts. And he gave me a job for him. I was the apprentice. And some of the Germans, they came in there, and then I asked them, they should let me also go outside. They take people to unload the trains, and they gave me the job, and I went with them, with the guard, the police. And from there, I ran away. There's quite a few people working on the train, on the tracks. And I went underneath the train and then ran away.
We knew my father was who anticipated. He said, don't go to Poland because they're gonna murder you. And I remembered that when I was lining up with my grandmother in the concentration camp. I remembered that. I said, I'm not going with you, Grandma. And why? Because my father said that you're going to die in Poland. They're going to murder you. I decided that I was pretending to be dancing with the music outside. So I pretended that I was just following the musicians. And they let me go. I escaped. I wake up in the morning and I remember Auschwitz in the morning. First thing that's what I remember, wakes me up. Well, what did you think I deserved to be here for anybody to remind me of Auschwitz? But that's what it does. You can't escape. I can't escape. And I found a person who was looking after me. He was a smuggler. My father had exemption to have me and my brother and my mother to survive with them. And they were in a hole together, and we all eventually became reunited. We had to defend ourselves. We were partisans. And we spent 5 months in the mountains.
They made a group to go to Israel. We got to go to Romania first. And from Romania, from Bucharest, boats were taking people to Israel. So we were 10 people, but then we put two and two and two and two. So we came in that city, and we stopped to eat lunch. And we had a small little suitcase, you know, very small. And we wanted to go out for a walk. So we asked in the restaurant if we could leave that little suitcase and we come back for it. When I came back to get it, there were already the police sitting and waiting for me. Me and my other boy. Why did they call the police? Because this boy who I was together with, he was from Poland. He didn't speak so good Hungarian, and they thought something, we're Jewish or something. And they took us to the police station. They wanted to transfer us someplace else. So we had to go through the street and through the bridge. And we saw on the bridge, the police were taking kids and banded them together with ropes, and they threw them to the Danube. And meanwhile, they took us in with the police trucks, and they took us up on top of the mountain. There was a police headquarters, and they put us in the room, all closed up, and there were the watchdogs outside, and only gave us to eat once a day a little soup and one piece of rye bread. We were there for 3 weeks. And then they wanted to transfer us someplace else. It was at night, me and another boy. So let's run away. let's run away, which we did. We sent by the farms, by the trees, until early in the morning. In the morning, we went into the city, Budapest. In Budapest, we looked up again the group, the organization, and then they gave us again false papers.
They took me to Buchenwald, and Buchenwald, they put us in those barracks. I didn't know nobody. We slept four in a bed. Not every morning, all four woke up. In the morning, they wake up, us up, and they gave us coffee. I didn't stay long in Buchenwald. They took me to sites where we made gasoline out of coal. But we didn't make any because we were bombed. We were bombed, and not 1 gallon gasoline was made there.
In the morning, when we get up, we had to go out and to stay per 555. And a lady, a German lady, came, and she was looking if we are all there. And this was in the afternoon and in the morning, twice a day. If they saw one is missing, we had to go in our places, sit down the whole day until they were looking if they found her. We had a koya and 1, 2, 4 people. And when we slept, if one tried, the other had to go in the site. It was very hard. We were with our mother in Auschwitz 6 months. From Altenburg, from Germany, came a guy. He said he needs 300 girls. He took me, my sisters too, but not my mother, because my mother was a little white. And we were all crying, the three sisters, we are going, and my mom stays alone here. My sister, Chaya Helen, she went to her, and she stays with her 2 months more. And in 2 months they came, they took my mom to the gas camera, and my sister stay alone. And my father, he had with his leg trouble. He didn't live too long. They put him in the gas camera. We were working in the night shift. We make munition. They give us the whole night a bowl of soup.
In Zmierinka, my father's own sister used to live there. Her husband is somehow they not took to the army because he was sometimes have a, you know, a defect, I don't know, they not took him. And he was working a bakery, you know. And we hear what German start, which Romania start looking because they know a lot of people escape. The house was a little bit big, we dig got tunnel. And the whole family be hiding there. And Germans, because they was looking for, and we was hiding there. And my grandfather, somehow he mentioned to come the same place. Bread we had because he was working in the bakery, this, it's, he bring us food, what we can. And at night we went out from the tunnel, and during the day we went back. During the day they was looking for the people, and they catch a lot of people who take back, and they was shot. 41 to 44, almost 3 years we were sitting there.
There's one man living in the same building who ran away, and he came home with a white uniform, Nazi uniform. And I talked to him, and he says, He ran away from the front. He didn't want to fight anymore. So he told me about what he did and this and that. He said he killed so many Jews, he killed so many Russians. We took this guy. We took him out from the basement because they were, all the people were in the basement because of the war. And he gave me the gun. And I took a black babushka in front of him and put his hands in the back of the chain. And the people outside there was a big terrace. They saw, and I took this guy and he gave me the gun and I shot him. I shot the Nazi. That was the end of him. That was the beginning of me.
When we was in the tunnel, we have a relative move in too, which a small child. And the child, he started crying. And he started crying when the Germans start looking for us. And I recall it, what his mother put his smile, you know, hand of your mother and almost choke him because, you know, his life, what, you know, what he can sacrifice his life for so many people.
I had 6 false papers until I was liberated. I was able to save myself, and I was liberated in Budapest.
We were walking one night and one day in another village, and some of the girls were very hungry, and they found raw potatoes, and they ate, and they died, all of them. We were afraid in the last minute they shouldn't shoot us because it was a few transports where they were walking and they couldn't walk, so they shot them, all of them, the airplanes and this and the Deutsche. They came and we had to be someplace they shouldn't see us. We were staying in the dish, 250 girls. There we were about 3-4 hours until it was a little quiet. No, we didn't saw nobody, only the lady was saying, "Girl, Shema Yisrael, we are liberated in a few minutes."
One morning, we get up and the yard isn't the same as it was. We had lookout towers with a German with a machine gun. There was nobody in there. And then we heard a few shots, the gates open. We seen coming in soldiers, tanks, trucks. We find out that those were the Allies army. Those were led by General Patton with Rabbi Hershey Schefter. The general was the Rebbeinu Shel Olam. The soldiers were the angels. They came to liberate us.
We have a radio, and we hear what from Moscow, he say it's over, the war is over.
This bulletin has come to you from the NBC newsroom in New York. The German news agency Transocean said today in a broadcast that the Allied invasion had begun.
Early Tuesday morning, numerous landing craft and light warships were observed in the area between the mouth of the Somme and the eastern coast of Normandy. At the same time, paratroops were dropped from numerous aircraft on the northern tip of the Normandy Peninsula.
This means invasion.
People you know, start went to street and start, you know, screaming and laughing, and it was celebration.
We were liberated. American soldiers, they came in, and they were going from house to house to say for the Germans, they should treat us good. We survived all the 5 children. We came home. We didn't find a father, a mother. And the house was broken. We come to Prague. And we were working a little there.
I went home and tried to see if anybody comes home from the concentration camp. Only guy, my brother, was survived, and he went to look for me, and I was looking for him. Finally, we got together.
We went to the house, was living, a policeman used to be the family live with. And slowly they start coming back to town. My wife, what she was, in a different city, she start coming. Life starts slowly go back to normal. We apply for visa. To visa went to Israel. They allowed to move to Israel.
My wife already wrote, she had an uncle in America, but she didn't know the address. So she wrote to one American Hungarian papers, and somebody read that paper who knows that uncle. And that uncle sent us the papers to come to America.
We went through the Mediterranean into the Atlantic Ocean and to New York Harbor, where, you know, it wasn't just us who were delighted to see the Statue of Liberty.
I distinctly remember passing this thing out in the water, which was described to me as the Statue of Liberty.
And I was, God bless America, God bless America.
That really was, to me, the border between my past life in Germany and my future life in America.
I came in 67. We came with a plane.
No money, no language, no when you want it. And I went down, I say, I must move in this. And my son had education, college, everything, and we did.
My sisters and brother, they were all here. My husband, I tell you the truth, didn't want it because he was in age. And he said, in this age, how can we move? But I start to cry. I have here the sisters, so we came here.
And we ended up in Fairmont, West Virginia, close to Pittsburgh, because over there you couldn't find nothing kosher. I had one suitcase. And even to come from Fairmont to Detroit, I still had one suitcase. And right now, thanks God, I have more than one suitcase.
My birthday, I dedicated a Torah. The rabbi ordered the Torah from Jerusalem. It came, and we had a party. I was very happy about it, to make my mind up to have my bar mitzvah.
The first class, first day, Hyde Park High School. And a few minutes later, after the bell had rung, a cute lady walked in and sat down. I will never live down, and now this is going on record. It's never been said before. And I said to her, "You're late." She hated me from that particular moment until a couple of years later when we started dating and we got married in 1956. I have 2 children. One has two sons, and the other has a son and two daughters. My father was Naftali ben Meir. Our German Jewish tradition was to reverse. So I am Meir ben Naftali. My firstborn son is then the same as my father, Naftali ben Meir. Firstborn sons of firstborn sons of firstborn sons. I went back 9 generations back to 1766. People started talking. They started talking, said, we must share our stories. And that's when this museum started, 1981 on Main Street. And it started with the survivors who started telling their stories to school groups. I'm considered first vice president of the museum. I was just a chair of the Heritage Committee, which I passed on to somebody else, where we work with survivors. And I'm on the Speakers Bureau.
When I arrived in Baltimore, when I greeted people, I used to shake their hand and curtsy. I was taught to curtsy when meeting people, and they said, no, you don't do that here. My experiences in going to school here was a great adjustment to make. I didn't speak the language, but eventually I did. And I guess I adjusted like most immigrants did. They go with the flow. My mother, they didn't know where their relative, who survived, did somebody survive? And there's a paper that was printed in the United States called the Aufbau, the rebuilding. And it was a Jewish German speaking paper. And people would look for people. And one day she found one of her sisters looking for family. And I remember the day, because I was home with her, you know, after school or something, and she let out a scream, and we ran across the street to her dear friend across the street. She had to tell somebody. And then I can see that like it was yesterday. One sister survived of all my family's siblings. Theresienstadt, that's where my family was. And from Theresienstadt, they went to Auschwitz. And they were one of the last transports. My brother wrote to his schoolmates and teachers when he came to the States. And they answered him, do you live in a big city? Is it as big as Hamburg? Are there many cars, buses, and bikes, and subways, elevated trains? I hope you can still read this letter. I think you may have forgotten the German already. I hope that you can write to us soon. I am always happy when a letter from you arrives. With sincere greetings, yours, Felix Wittmund. The teachers and the students all got murdered. I was in training to be a nurse, and my late husband was there with his brother at the same hotel, and we were sitting on a row, I think we're playing bingo or something. And in those days, I thought I was very sophisticated if I took a cigarette out and just lit it, you know, for effect. And I took a cigarette out, and all of a sudden this arm comes up the row and lights my cigarette, and that's how we met. In 1956, we got married in Baltimore at the Chizakamuna Synagogue. I have 3 children. I have my daughter Linda here, and I have a son Simon in Boston, and another son Michael in Virginia. I was at a meeting at my synagogue, and they were talking about doing things in the community, and somebody brought up what was happening to the Jews in the Soviet Union. And I said, we got to do something. I organized a gathering and to protest if we can go up in space together, you can get a lot of people go. When I was working for the Soviet Jews, there were so many things I did and letters I wrote. Oh, letters all the time. I had boxes of stuff. And I thought to myself, what's going to happen when I'm not here anymore? You know, the kids, they're not interested, it's too much. So now it's in the Yeshiva University in the archives.
We have 2 sons. One is, if you heard of Yeshiva Beit Yehuda, he's teaching there, he's a rabbi there about 35 years. And one is a lawyer here in Michigan.
I have a nice family. I have a daughter. I have 2 grandsons, nice, and 2 great-grandchildren.
when I found out from my relatives that I have here, we gave a guy who went to New York, and we gave him a piece of paper with the names of my mother and father and so forth, and he put it in the forwards newspaper. And my uncle here happened to read it and found that ad. And they sent me a telegram. And they found each other. And they signed for me. And I came to America. I met my wife. We got married on June 12, 1949.
We are saying, Shephol Doiru Doirum Dumulan, in every generation, the world is trying to kill off the Jews. And we are here.
Don't allow anybody to create anti-Semitism. You have to speak up. You need to speak up loud.
Have courage. Don't give up. Fight. Be a mensch.
Know what's going on. There's so much anti-Semitism now that is frightening.
The Holocaust you should never forget. Never, ever. It's very painful thing, but God forbid, you should know about it.
Be an upstander. Do the right thing.
We have to fight not to have this anti-Semitism. Yivarechecho Adonai v'yishmerecho, Yor Adonai ponav alecho v'chenecho,
Even though Mr. Harold Katz has been through many hardships in his life, he still came out of the war happy to be Jewish, and that no matter what happens to you, you should also always be happy to be Jewish and be happy to be part of this community.
Don't let that Holocaust ever be forgotten.
Instead of expecting things to happen the way I want them to, actively trying and going and to try making them happen.
We should do everything in our power to make sure that it never happens again.
We had this opportunity to do the Names Not Numbers interview. These stories will never be forgotten, even in the next generations to come.
I told what I went through, and I hope God should help you. You should know for a better life. You should know never from bad things, only from good things. I wish you all, the youngsters.
The Names Not Numbers experience is something that will last me for a lifetime. Knowing that I was able to be a part of select few kids who are able to dive into people's stories of the Holocaust and be able to realize that we can't ever forget this, that what really happened back then, that we have to be able to study the story and be able to share it by making a movie.
It's time, it's deserved, that we should have taka, the Gila Shalim. We do have a little. We have a little country, we have respect, but we need the whole thing. And we are telling that to God. Kasha de Bartu, you told us. So that's the thing what we want, and I say we deserve it.
Anima.
I need.